Welcome back. You're watching To The Point. If you thought General V.K. Singh would stop creating controversy because he's become a minister, you are sadly wrong. A thoughtless tweet has become the big story of the day, and the reason is it compares the army chief designate to a criminal and accuses units of the army of dacoity and killing innocents. With me to discuss this disturbing development is former army chief and the hero of Kargil, General V.P. Malik, former deputy chief and chairman of the ex-servicemen's movement, Lieutenant General Raj Kadian, Congress MP and spokesperson Abhishek Singhvi, and BJP national executive member Sheshadri Chari. General Kadian, yesterday in a tweet, General V.K. Singh, a former army chief and now a minister of state, effectively called General Dalbir Singh Sohag, the army chief designate, a criminal and accused him of supporting dacoity. How do you, as a former army officer, respond to that?
Karan, for nearly 3 years now, the name of General V.K. Singh has been synonymous with controversy. With him now wearing a different hat, it was expected that he will focus on the new responsibilities and contribute constructively to nation building. Unfortunately, he seems mired in the past. He apparently has not got over the fact that his negative opinion of General Sohag was not taken as the last word. He cannot get over that fact. The statement that has come out in the press that he apparently has made has very serious connotations both for the army and for the country as such. He has accused the chief designate of the Indian Army for at least conniving with criminality, if not being a criminal himself. Even more serious for the army, he has accused the GCOs and Jawans of being dacoits and criminals. It is never heard of from an ex-chief coming like this, accusing his own people. If the incident actually took place in 2010 March, if the incident was so serious as to punish a corps commander, why not the moral responsibility of the army commander? He himself was the army commander at that time. That event seems to have been forgotten. For the nation, you know, he has been making anti-government statements ever since he lost the Supreme Court case. The UPA government did not or could not discipline him. But it was expected that the new dispensation, which is reputed to have a strong center of gravity, will at least ensure that the voices of different ministers are harmonious. That does not seem to be the case.
General Malik, General V.K. Singh's tweet was a response to an affidavit filed by the Defence Ministry in the Supreme Court calling the disciplinary action that General V.K. Singh took against General Sohag in 2012 illegal, extraneous and premeditated. Does that background justify the tweet, and does it justify the way he refers to the next army chief?
Karan, let me first explain to you that the process, the system and the process that we have in the army of appointment of the army commanders and the chief is a fairly detailed one in which the army itself has got very little role to play. The army commanders, after giving input, we do recommend, the army chief recommends that, but as far as the army chiefs are concerned, the army has no role. The chief also does not recommend that. He only gives inputs. So the whole process is done primarily in the Ministry of Defense. Now, these affidavits were also passed by the Ministry of Defense after taking input from the army. And they were seen by the legal advisor who is posted in the Ministry of Defense when they were sent to the Armed Forces Tribunal earlier, and the latter one to the Supreme Court. Now, the language is that of the legal advisor. Whatever he has used, it's a strong language indeed. But factually, as far as I am concerned, the army has no role to play in the language that has been written and the issue that has been taken up by the Ministry of Defense in the AFT and in the Supreme Court.
Can I then, General Malik, conclude from your answer that nothing in that affidavit handed by the MOD to the Supreme Court justifies either the language in General V.K. Singh's tweet or the way General V.K. Singh refers to General Sohag?
No, as far as, look, I have not appreciated what he has tweeted or what he has said. In fact, I feel that he has no role to play. As far as this case is going on between General Dastane and the Ministry of Defense, why did he have to intervene? None of the previous chiefs has ever intervene in such affairs of the army. We feel that the persons who are responsible, the chief and his team, they are not only responsible, they are also accountable, and the ex-chiefs have always stayed away from such controversies. So there was no need for him to intervene.
Okay.
As far as the process is concerned, all I am saying is that, look, the whole thing has been scrutinized in detail and our system is very good. In fact, I have seen many political leaders at the very senior level appreciating our system.
Okay.
Of selection of the army commanders and selection of the chiefs. And the army itself has got a very small role in that. So that's what I'm trying to say, that our system is so good. Why did he have to intervene from outside as an ex-chief?
Mr. Chari, according to today's Hindu front page, Arun Jaitley has reportedly asked officials of the Defence Ministry to explain why they referred in that affidavit to General V.K. Singh in the terms they did. But it transpires that in fact the affidavit given to the Supreme Court is identical to the affidavit that was given last year to the Armed Forces Tribunal. And if the two affidavits had changed, or the Defence Ministry had changed its position, it would have been guilty of effectively perjury. So in fact, they had no choice but to give the same affidavit with the same language to the Supreme Court.
I think the Raksha Mantri has said in Parliament should be the final words. He has very categorically said that the present decision of the UPA government to appoint General Sughag as the army chief stands. It is final and it is irrevocable. I think we respected the judgment of the UPA government when they appointed General V.K. Singh as the army chief. We also respected the judgment of the UPA government when they appointed the next army chief, and we discussed this issue at length. Of course, there was an issue of propriety. The UPA government, which was practically outgoing government, and they need not have hurried through this, but even then we agreed in principle to the appointment of General Sughag as the army chief. So there is no question of looking back into this issue.
One quick question. Subramaniam Swamy, now a colleague of yours and a senior member of your party, has publicly called for a rethink on General Sohag's appointment as army chief. Are you saying that that is a lone voice and it will not influence the BJP government?
See, when the Raksha Mantri says something in Parliament, I think he is saying that with full authority and all the command that he respects.
Now, Abhishek Singhvi, there's no doubt that General V.K. Singh, as a Minister of State with independent charge, has seriously embarrassed the government today. But what was the need for Congress to demand that he either resign or be removed? After all, when General V.K. Singh, as the sitting army chief, took your government to court, which is a far more serious matter, you neither sacked him nor made any demand that he should resign. Why now, over a lesser issue, are you suddenly demanding the sack or resignation?
Karan, there are various facets of this which have to be seen. First of all, Mr. V.K. Singh is now Mr. V.K. Singh, not General V.K. Singh, and is a minister. As a sitting minister, his own government expresses clear, categorical lack of confidence in him in an affidavit sworn on solemn affirmation before no less than the Supreme Court. It virtually calls him biased, premeditated. Secondly, I was the first to take the briefing yesterday. Mr. V.K. Singh's conduct subsequent to that shows that he has no regard for institutions. He has virtually abused the current chief designate, virtually in the tweets. He has kind of been like a misguided or unguided missile flying in all directions, irrespective of the constitutions, irrespective of the effect on the institution which he has served for so long. And thirdly, the very important point being missed out, Karan, is that this was an affidavit filed 2 days ago. There is absolute and full power in the government of India to change nuances, to change language, tone down, tone up, alter, modify, without doing any perjury. It's a government of India headed by the Modi Sarkar, of which he's a minister,
okay,
which has consciously filed an affidavit 2 days ago. This is not some kind of an automatic transfer of affidavit. You take a photocopy of the armed forces affidavit and you file it in the Supreme Court. Please,
okay,
don't misunderstand.
Can I
not the situation in courts.
Can I underline?
Serious matter. Lastly, one more second. He has, in fact, his conduct post yesterday, he has compounded the felony, if I may use that phrase. Because he has absolutely kind of made it personal. He is going all over the place. And he's, in fact, earlier he took action to destroy and undermine the army, and he's doing it now.
All right.
There's no question of us dismissing him. He was retiring in a short while. The date was known.
Okay.
We didn't want to make a victim out of him.
I just want to underline for the audience a very important point you made, and I imagine you're making it, in fact, with your lawyer hat on, not just your Congress spokesman hat, that, in fact, the government had the right, if it wanted to amend the affidavit given to the Supreme Court, it didn't have to give a similar affidavit as the affidavit given last year to the Armed Forces Tribunal. And if it had amended the affidavit, it wouldn't have been guilty of perjury, from which it follows that if it didn't amend the affidavit and gave the same affidavit, then this government chose to stand by the very position taken by your government in September when you went to the AFT. That's a very important point you're making, and I want to put that to you, Mr. Chari.
And a vote of no confidence in a sitting minister.
Okay, but that's another point. That's a very interesting point. Your government had a chance to amend. If it had amended, it wouldn't have been perjury, and therefore, if it doesn't amend, it's standing by the position taken with the September affidavit to the AFT. That's very important. In other words, the MOD really meant to say what it said. It wasn't an oversight.
No, it's not that. See, the MOD is 15 days into this government. This new government probably did not have any new facts. You will amend it only if you have any new facts.
So there was no reason to amend it.
So there is no reason for amending it. Probably they would still, if this issue had not come up before the Supreme Court in this manner, in this hurried manner, there were no new facts, and the same thing.
That's a very fair point. No new facts, therefore no need
Absolutely.
To amend. I want to come back, General Kadian, to the point you made, which is the relationship between General V.K. Singh and General Sohag, because that clearly lies at the very core of this whole controversy and the tweet. Now, the truth is that in 2012, just days before his own retirement as Army Chief, General V.K. Singh imposed a disciplinary ban on General Sohag. And he did that despite the fact that the Defence Minister had cleared General Sohag for promotion to Army Commander.
Yeah.
Secondly, again, as sitting Army Chief, General V.K. Singh gave a series of interviews where he questioned and criticised General Sohag's credibility. And he did it to a variety of different channels all at one go. And then thirdly, General V.K. Singh tried very hard to get the UPA not to take a decision appointing the new Army Chief. He wanted it left to the new government. And many people believe that the real reason was that he hoped that the new government would overlook General Sohag, appoint the next in line, who happened to be General Ashok Singh, his samdhi. Therefore, is this whole issue really vitiated by a personal animosity, if that's the right word, between V.K. Singh and Sohag?
It will be difficult to ascribe motives, but yes, there is circumstantial evidence. There is another fact that you're missing out, Karan. In 2012, all efforts were made to prevent General Bikram Singh from becoming chief. A case was filed in J&K court alleging that he was involved in a fake encounter. If that had succeeded, if Bikram Singh had not become the chief, then again Sohag would have been sidelined and somebody else would have become. So that it is only at that time General V.K. Singh himself recommended General Sohag to be the next army commander in his report. It's only when General Bikram Singh, to derail his appointment, did not succeed that Sohag was targeted. He was targeted on an issue that took place 1 year before he joined the court.
To put it in layman's terms, what you're clearly suggesting is that General V.K. Singh is playing politics.
That's circumstantial evidence, I said, suggests that he was trying to work out a chosen line of succession, both through Bikram Singh first and then through General Sohag.
General Malik, you're a former army chief, and more than anything else, you care deeply about two things. You care deeply about that high office of army chief, and you care deeply about the army itself as an institution. If it is the case, and circumstantial evidence seems to suggest, as General Kadian says, that it could be, that personal vendetta and personal politics is the motivation behind what General V.K. Singh is doing, then has General V.K. Singh damaged the status and dignity of the army chief's office?
Look, I have no hesitation in saying that the kind of statements that he has made, he has damaged the institution of the army chief, and also he has damaged the reputation of the army also. We've never had such a case that an ex-army chief speaking so badly against the new army chief, the last army chief speaking one of the ex-army chiefs speaking so badly about the new army chief. It's never done. I can't think of even a single instance. So unfortunately, he has done a lot of damage, not only to the institution of the chief, but even the whole reputation of the army. And therefore, I'm not trying to keep put any motive, but all I can say is that he needs to be a little more careful in his statements and his tweets.
You know, one other question, General Malik. Last year, when General V.K. Singh claimed that the army had regularly bribed all politicians in Jammu and Kashmir, all his predecessors, all the living past army chiefs issued a statement dissociating themselves from that claim. I don't believe this has ever happened before, where all previous army chiefs have dissociated themselves from what one person has said. Wasn't that, in a sense, an unprecedented rebuff?
Yeah, that is right. But you know, how can... The problem is that when you go public with such wild statements, then somebody has to correct them. Otherwise, the whole public, the Indian public, will get a very wrong impression. And I was one of those people who had said, okay, this is not correct. We have never done it. Nobody has ever done it. So that's what I'm saying, that some of the statements that he has made in public, I'm afraid, he needs to be more careful about these.
In fact, in a very real sense, that statement by you and your colleagues dissociating yourself from General V.K. Singh should have been a lesson. It should have taught him to be more cautious. It doesn't seem to have taught him anything. Would you agree with that?
Well, since he's made similar mistake again, I would agree with that.
All right. I think that smile and genial laugh suggests the answer is yes, but you're too diplomatic to put it so bluntly. Mr. Charlie, let me put this to you. Beyond the present controversy, and that present controversy is bad enough because it's embarrassed your government, General V.K. Singh was the first Indian Army chief to take the government to court, to claim politicians in Kashmir are regularly bribed, to politicize the process of the appointment of chief. And then finally, there were those suspicious troop movements in January 2012, which were subsequently confirmed or corroborated by a former DGMI, General A.K. Chaudhary. And all of this suggests that should a man with this background have been made a minister in the Modi government?
You know, his qualification to become the minister does not emanate from the fact that he was the army chief, or the actions that he took as army chief, or the actions that he took as army chief to former army chief to protect his dignity and honor. He made it a personal issue. He went to the people. He went and told the people, and people had trust and faith in him. Don't forget that he has won an election.
That wipes out the background?
It need not necessarily wipe out the background, but that is the oft-repeated remark that many politicians give from all sections of the society. Therefore, let us keep these two things
You're
separate.
You're also a diplomat. I notice your clever words.
That.
The oft-repeated mark that politicians often make is that an election wipes out the background, but you added, so it doesn't necessarily have to wipe out the background. That's a very interesting thought you're leaving me with. It doesn't have to. Politicians claim it does, but it doesn't have to.
But his political standing as a victorious candidate in an election gives him enough moral and legal authority to head a ministry.
All right. I accept that.
And the prerogative of the Prime Minister is to choose any of the members of Parliament to become a minister.
Mr. Singhvi, what can Congress do if after having demanded either the sack or that he resign, neither happens?
Well, I don't think we can do anything much on that front, but that's not the point. There are two very important points which arise from what you just said, Karan. One, and especially since you yourself understand the army better than most anchors do, the crux of the army is the spirit de corps. It's that unity of spirit, despite differences.
Okay.
I think for the first time in living history, you have found Mr. V.K. Singh reducing it to cabals and squabbles and groupism and suspicion. The second is very important. I think your question was not quite understood or answered fully by Mr. Chari. I understand your question to me. Yes, nobody can deny him the right to stand, and he won by a big margin, so he's eligible. Should Mr. Modi have chosen, there is a question of choice there. He certainly is not obliged to choose a person
okay.
with a background which puts personal interest above institutional interest, especially of an institution like the army,
okay,
for a lifetime.
I take your point.
The examples you've given show
I take your point.
Taking it personally, and there I think Mr. Modi should not have chosen him. Therefore,
very quickly, I want to go to General Malik with something else. I want to go beyond just what General V.K. Singh has said. I want to ask you how the army will view two things. First, General Malik, how will the army view a minister who accuses the army chief designate of protecting dacoits and effectively calls the army chief designate a criminal? How will the army view such a minister?
Full abuse.
Not well at all. They would be shocked. And that is what I am saying, that there is no need for him to be making such statements. You know, it is reflecting on the army, which has a certain reputation across the board amongst all the political parties. And our systems are appreciated, respected by all political parties of selection of the army commanders and the chiefs.
Okay.
When you pass such comments, whether you are inside the government or outside the government, obviously the army will not take it well.
A second quick question, General Malik. How will the army view the fact that in that tweet, General V.K. Singh has effectively called the Jawans of Third Corps dacoits and murderers? Because when he says they kill innocent people, that makes them murderers. And when he says they're involved in dacoity, that makes them dacoits. How will Indian Army soldiers view their colleagues being called dacoits and murderers? By an army chief, by the way.
Look, the point is that, as I said, our system is such that it goes over these issues in detail before somebody is appointed as an army commander or as an army chief, and he should know it. So after that, to call somebody a murderer or somebody who has encouraged these things or who has tried to hide, I think it is absolutely wrong. There was no need for him to make such a vile statement. It's not only incorrect statement, because the facts would be known to people in the army headquarters as well as in the Ministry of Defense, but to pass them in public like this, I think it's a big damage that you are doing to your own institution, an institution in which you have served for so many years and you have headed it.
Has General V.K. Singh diminished himself in the eyes of A, serving officers and serving jawans, and B, retired officers and retired jawans?
Karan, 2 points. Firstly, Indian Army is a very disciplined force. It's a regular army. They are not a bunch of cowboys who go on the gung-ho motto. Therefore, it is expected that anybody who refers to their chief designate should use language that is dignified and respectful and not make irresponsible allegations which are unproven. Number two, I think by now everybody knows that V.K. Singh has a loose mouth. So most of the people will see through the truth and they are going to take it as a personal pique and not a serious remark.
Very quickly, my last question. Given the fact that a former army chief has called the soldiers of a unit of Third Corps people who kill innocents, he's accused them of dacoity, does he owe those soldiers an apology?
I think the least he should do is to withdraw his tweet. Rest of it is up to the BJP.
He hasn't withdrawn his tweet. He's actually this evening said,
he should apologize. He should apologize to the jawans, if not to the chief. Chief can understand. But to the jawans, I said it is even more serious that you accuse JCOs and jawans of a criminal activity without any legal proof.
So he should apologize to the jawans?
I think he should.
All right. On that note, we're going to end this particular episode. My thanks to both of you coming to studio. My thanks also to General Malik as well as Abhishek Singhvi. And there we end this episode. If you have been, thanks for watching. Goodbye. Good night.